you tonight in this Shloshim memorial of our Rav Avraham ben Arav Meir Dan, Rabbi Dr. Abraham Lipshitz, Zecher Tzadik L'Vracha. Dr. Lipshitz taught for decades in our yeshiva and was extremely respected for his scholarship throughout the world. I clearly recall on one occasion when the entire HBC program was openly praised by an academic dean in another city, due to the fact that it was Dr. Lipshitz, and particularly him, who was a member, an active member of our faculty. I felt honored to have been able to work with Dr. Lipshitz while I was here at the yeshiva, and I consider it a great privilege to have a moment to introduce, to be part of this program, to introduce tonight's speakers. Our speakers will give you an insight into this extraordinary Talmud office and how blessed we were to have had him in our yeshiva and in our community. The order of presentation, first the Rosh HaYeshiva, Rav Avram Friedman, followed by family members, daughter Rosie Nathan, and nephew Rabbi Leon Lipshitz, and two of Dr. Lipshitz's students, first is Talmud Muvhak, Rabbi Dr. Mordechai Goodman, and then Rabbi Michael Myers, who will share his perspective, and then conclude the Shloshim with Kale Mulley.
That we have here in the yeshiva tonight to pay tribute to Shloshim, to such a special, important person, a great Talmud Chacham, real tzaddik, someone that it's hard to describe and just hard to believe such a person existed in the Kosta yeshiva, in the walls of yeshiva, but it's such a special person. We don't find people like this. You know, sometimes you find a person who knows Shas, but he's not so familiar with this or, let's say, of Tanakh, or Lashon HaKodesh, Dikdom. But some people are Bekiyam in Lashon HaKodesh, Dikdom. They know Tanakh, they don't know so much Shas. But Dr. Lipshitz was somebody who was very unique. A person who knew Shas, who knew Tanakh, and he knew Lashon HaKodesh, and such a high level, world famous in those fields, all of them. And not only was he such a scholar, but his midas, I always say he was a prince of a man, special person. You know, he was honored here at the yeshiva every year. He was honored with the kavod that he was psicha to ne'ilim. He opened up the aram for ne'ilim. I was thinking that perhaps that he was given this honor because Psicha, for Neila, we know the Yom HaKodesh, the holiest day of the year, Yom Kippur. You open up our hearts, you open up our minds to know that the Kedushas Hayom of Yom Kippur is finishing. They're losing now, there's no more Yom Kippur, that's it. The last moments of Yom Kippur. I think that Dr. Lipshitz, he's able to close that period that was before the war. The special type of Talmud Chacham, special type of a person, of worldly Talmud Chacham that there was before the World War, he was able to close up that tefillah for us. He was able to open it up and make the Neila also at the same time. So that's, he was given that honor, but it was very apropos and very fitting that he should be the one who's Noel, he lock it in for us. The special, we can see that type of a Talmud Chacham. We see that the Mus, we don't see so often. We don't see it too often, something very unique. That type of a Talmud Chacham. He was a very modest person. It's very hard to really know the person. He certainly would never tell you, you know, certain things about his knowledge and greatness. People would hear him and learn from him. They would know what he is, who he is. But he'd never tell you. Sometimes though I got him, sometimes I'm off guard, I get a little conversation and find out some details about his life. He told me when he was a young boy, you know, there was the great yeshiva of Chachmei Lublin, of Rabbi Shapiro, the one who's famous, world famous for Daf Yomi, the great Rav, a great Gaon. So he had a yeshiva, Chachmei Lublin, and that yeshiva, in order to be accepted in the yeshiva, so they the test to be accepted, they were young boys, boys of 15, 16 years old. So the boys did test, I understand, to be accepted in the yeshiva. He had to know 200 plot Gemara al-Peh. black Gemara about that. You know, many people today, you know, the Rabbanim can think such a machina. But that was the machina, the entrance exam to the Chachmei Lublin Yeshivit. So why did I mention that? Because Dr. Lipshitz told me one time, Agavurche told me, you know, he took the machina. I remember he told me there was a yid that he didn't really know who the person was. He told him to go on a certain base medrash. He said he sat there and he was a fella, very skinny fella sitting in a corner in torn garment. Didn't know who the fella was. All of a sudden, he said, maybe you're here to take the machina. And he gave him the machina. This person knew the whole gospel bad. And he gave him the faher, he gave him the test, and he passed. He was accepted, the Chachmei Lublin, then the war broke out, so he never really went to yeshiva. But that's the matrei. We're talking about a person who was accepted to the, let's say, the Harvard of yeshivas as a young boy, 15 years old. You know, I saw a word that's about the shir, the Ramban, a beautiful Ramban, Parsha Mishalaf. It says in the Ramban of Mishalaf, it says on a posik, it says they came to a place called Elimo. And Elimo, it's a Beyoba Elimo, and there was at that place 12 Mayanos, Mayim, and Shivim Tamarim. There were 12 springs of water, and there was 70 palm trees. So the Ramban says, well, what is it telling us this detail? We don't find that in many Masa'ot, we learn in Parshas Masrei. It doesn't explain to us all the details of all those places. Why does the Torah tell us that there's that we have over here 12 Mayanos, Mayim, and 70 Tamarim? Why was it so important? It says some places have thousands of date trees. To tell me there's 70 date trees, why is that so important? So Ramban says, I'll tell you why. He thinks because he brings a Mechilta. It says in the Mechilta that this was from my separations, HaKadosh Baruch Hu from my separations, in the Bria, he already had in his mind, there's going to be these 12 springs of water and 70 Tamarim. Why? For the 12 tribes of Israel, all the Shvatim, each one has his own well of water, and the 70 are for the 70 for the Skadim, for Sanhedrin. So he understood the Pshat was like this in Ramban, that in order to give over the Torah, this was mentioned right before Kabbalah's Torah, in order to give over the Torah, you have to know that the Torah is for every Jew. For all the Shvatim, not for just one type of person. The Torah is for everybody. And also it's given over, you have to have a Zekanim, you have to have a Masoret, you have to have a Chachamim, the Gedolim, to give over the Torah. The other I saw Dr. Lipshitz, he was able to give over the Torah to so many different types of people, because his knowledge was so broad. All different types, not just in Lomdus, in Torah, in Gemara, not only in Lashon Kodesh, in Dikduk, or in Tanakh. He was able to give, because Klal Yisrael has Torah in so many different forms. Every Shevet has a different type of Torah. And he was from the Zekanim. In order to give over the Torah in this generation, especially HaKadosh Baruch Hu, had to make a special Baruch Hu. And after the Holocaust, we needed somebody to give over the Masoret. We lost such a Masoret. We don't have those Gedolim. So this was, as I said, the Ne'ilah from that door. The Ne'ilah from that generation was that Dr. Lipshitz, you could see, the giving over the Masoret when Abba to all the Talmidim, all the types of Talmidim that he was able to give over to. I want to close with a personal note that I heard from Dr. Lipshitz myself. He also, I read a lot of times Kutraisim, I read for the summer. So I give it out to certain people. Usually a person says, thank you. And sometimes they even say, oh, that was very nice, tickle favor, you wrote something nice. But I gave over to Dr. Lipshitz every time I gave over to him. And he's such a scholar, such a gentleman. He always told me it's so beautiful. I love those shtickla. I mean, I don't know, it made me feel so unbelievably good. Such a scholar to say that, just maybe that you know how to make a person feel special because he's such a special person. That's the person that we're giving honor to tonight. And we have such an honor to give honor to such a Talmud Chacham, somebody who's going to show, who showed us for so many decades what it really means to be a Talmud Chacham, to be at the highest level and a prince of a man.
Thirst for Torah, Ivrit, Navi, and prose. So many of our questions surrounding the Shoah are unfortunately unanswered because of the great loss. I would like to, in these few minutes, offer my perspective on this fundamental question of what sustained our father, Rabbi Dr. Avraham Lipshitz, Zichrono Livracha, to choose life, to love, and to learn in the face of such adversity after the war. Less than a fortnight ago, we took note of Tu Bishvat. I mention this because the answer we are searching for, albeit only partially, lies within the symbolism of Tu Bishvat. As we have all learned, Mishnah Rosh Hashanah states, Arba Rosh Hashanah Hein Be'achad Bishvat, Rosh Hashanah Le'ilan K'divrei Beit Shammai, Beit Hillel Omrim B'chamisha Asar. We paskin in line with Beit Hillel that the date of the new year is the 15th of Shvat. However, both Beit Shammai and Beit Hillel agree. Regarding the concept of a new year for the trees, new fruits are beginning to set, a time of renewal. We delineate between the old and the new. This Mishnah makes us acutely aware that we must always acknowledge and respect our natural environment, our life support system. Tu Bishvat singles out the tree as the focal point of this lifeline. The Midrash in Kohelet Rabbah relays that when Hashem created man, he took man into the garden, showed him all the trees. God showed man their beauty and commanded man to be careful not to destroy them. The Midrash singles out the trees and not the garden at large. What is unique to the trees that warrants this delineation? Trees transform the earth from a lifeless existence to an environment capable of supporting other life, such as the animal kingdom and that of human beings. There is, though, a duality of a relationship between trees and human mankind. As we read in Dvarim Kaf, Pasuk Yud Tet, Ki Ha'adam Eitz Hasadeh. Although we have singled out the tree as supporting life, human beings do so as well. This is but one of the similarities between trees and man. Both man and trees emanate from a seed, and for both man and trees, the firstborn and first fruits are an exciting moment in the affirmation of life. Both require support, nourishment, and care to develop their potential. Mankind and trees continue to develop and blossom because of a mutual interaction. In recognition of and thanks to Creator of all, man is called upon to bless Hashem for this wonder of creation. Bavli Brachot 43 Bet states that one who goes out in the month of Nisan and sees a blooming tree should say a special bracha to thank the Kodesh Baruch Hu for creation that provides benefit to man. Basic sustenance is but one way trees support life. We read in Dvarim Chet, Pasuk Zayin Chet, God's description of the beautiful and lush land wherein he stipulates five fruit-bearing trees. Ki Hashem Elokecha mebiyacha el eretz tova, eretz nachle mayim, ayanot utohomot, yotzim v'bikau bahar, eretz chita u'seora, gefen u'te'ena, v'rimon, eretz zayin shemen u'tvash. We learn, along with the basic sustenance, our value system is also associated with the tree. We learn of the act of hachnasat orchim of Avraham Avinu in Bereshit, Yudchet Pasuk David. Yukachna me'at ma'im v'rachatzu raglechem v'hishanu tachat ha'etz. V'hishanu tachat ha'etz. We note in Shoftim that justice is carried out under the Tomer tree by Dvorah when we need to be there and defend ourselves. The discussion with Gidon to engage in war also takes place under the tree. It is possible that these life-affirming acts are linked to the tree to remind us of the original divine creation of the life-sustaining tree. But whereas the tree functions as our collective memory and basic sustenance, it is man who must actualize the message of the tree. Our father, Rabbi Dr. Abraham Lipshitz, Zichrono Livracha, was such a man. He was a gifted soul, a man whose roots were in the Torah, in Jewish life. He had a natural understanding of the meaning of Brit HaOlam, Briat HaOlam, and the values of Judaism. At the same time, he also recognized the beauty and value of the land we were given. Part of his natural understanding of these important issues was the importance of passing on his knowledge. For our father, it was imperative to try and imbue the future generations with this understanding. Our father planted the seeds in many students, was blessed to see the fruits of many students, and accomplished leaving a legacy of deep roots that will continue his derech of deeply loving our Torah and our land. Lastly, I would like to thank all of you who came here tonight to give kavod to our father. I hope that his memory lasts as a pillar of this Torah-loving institution.
Gemara in Sanhedrin, Pei Chesamet Beis, relates the following. Sholchu Mitam. They sent a letter from Eretz Yisrael to Bavel. And the letter asked the following question. Ezehu ben Olam Haba. Who is a native? Who is a person who's a member of Olam Haba? And the letter answered as follows. Advasan Ushpal Berech. Somebody who's an Anav, somebody who's humble and considers himself as if his height is only up till his knees. Shayef Ayel, Shayef Benofak. Somebody who enters a room stooped over, hunched over. When he enters a room, he's hunched over, and when he leaves the room, he's hunched over. He's inconspicuous. And the final attribute is Goris Biaraisa Tadiro. He's constantly sitting and learning. The law machsik tivuse lenashe. And he doesn't consider himself anything special because of the fact that he's sitting and learning. The obvious question that comes up on this Gemara is, everybody knows that there's a Mishnah that was learned hundreds of years before this letter that the Amoraim in Eretz Yisrael sent to Bava. The Mishnah specifically says, Kol Yisrael yesh lehem chelek la'olam haba. So why would the Amoraim from Eretz Yisrael send a letter that says, Ezehu ben olam haba? But the answer is obvious. Everybody is allowed into the arena. Every Jew gets into the arena of olam haba. What the letter is asking is, Ezehu ben olam haba. Everybody gets into the stadium, but what the letter wants to know is, who's a player on the field? Who are the people that are the main characters? So the Gemara answers, Advasa, somebody who's an anav, the goris biaraisa tadiro, and somebody who's constantly sitting and learning. My uncle Avrom was the personification of this Gemara. My uncle Avrom Lipshitz was born in the early 20th century to Rav Meir Dunn and Dvorah Lipshitz in Lodz, Poland. His family was extremely close. His father, Meir Dunn, he had two brothers, Michal and Lozu, Sam's grandfather. My grandfather, Dr. Lipshitz's father, lived in Lodz, Poland, while the other two brothers and most of the Lipshitz mishpacha lived in Piatkov. The dedication that the brothers had to each other was legendary. Avram learned in Alexander Yeshiva in Lodz, and because of his chen, which he possessed throughout his life, and his charisma, he eventually procured a position with a bank, with a Jewish bank in Lodz. Unfortunately, this was a highly prized occupation, especially for an Alexander Chosid. Unfortunately, on September 1st, 1939, my uncle's banking career came to a screeching halt. The next 5.5 years would only get worse and worse. In 1942, 4 days before Rosh Hashanah, the Nazis, Yimach Shimon, organized one of their liquidations of the lunch ghetto, and my grandfather, Meir Dunn, my uncle Avram's father, was taken away from the mishpacha, never to be heard of again. My uncle, Rav Avram, my grandfather, Rav Meir Dunn, corresponded with many Gedolei Yisrael prior to the war, including Rav Chaim Berlin. And my uncle Avram put together a kuntris, which he named Zichro Meir Dunn, to describe, to go over all the chidushim of my grandfather. In his introduction to Zichro Meir Dunn, my uncle Avram describes the utter despair in the ghetto with the following story. As I mentioned before, one of his uncles was Michal. This was the uncle who I think drew him into the world of Tanakh. Unfortunately, Michal and his wife Shifra were never able to have children. For 20 years, they couldn't have children. And of course, they davened Hashem. They went to every single Hasidic Rebbe. And finally, after almost 20 years of marriage, they were finally able to have a child. They had a daughter. Unfortunately, tragically, when the Nazis invaded Piatnikov, the town where Michal lived, they brutally murdered Michal's daughter and wife. Now on Pesach, 1943, the only two Lipshitzes who were still surviving in the Piatnikov ghetto were Michal and Michal's nephew, Yechiel Lipshitz, known here in Chicago as Henry Lipshitz. Henry was a young teenager, and he remembered the beautiful story the family would share together, and he wanted to share Pesach with Michal. When he approached Michal's quarters, he heard Michal reciting something which he assumed to be the Haggadah Shel Pesach. Henry begged Michal to let him in, but Michal refused, and he demanded that Henry leave. As Henry was leaving, he again heard Michal reciting something. But this time Henry listened more closely, and he realized that what Michal was reciting was not the Haggadah Shel Pesach, but was instead Megillas Eicha. In August 1944, the lunch ghetto was completely liquidated. And my uncle Avram and my father, Yibar L'chaim Tovin, were put on tail cars to be transported to Auschwitz-Birkenau. They spent 3 weeks in Birkenau. And after 3 weeks, they were transferred to a small labor concentration camp named Altheimer. In Altheimer, my uncle Avram first worked as a construction worker, which was almost a sentence of death. Baruch Hashem, he was transferred from the construction work and he was transferred to the laundry. They spent until December 1944 in Altheimer. In December 1944, when the Nazis were being attacked by the Russians on the Eastern Front, the Nazis evacuated Altheimer and they began the death marches. They marched for 3 days from Altheimer to Gleiwitz. In Gleiwitz, they were put in open rail cars, my father and my uncle Avram, and they traveled for a week, subsisting only on a diet of snow in the open rail cars until they reached Dora Nordhausen. They stayed in Dora Nordhausen from January 1945 until April 1945. Finally, in April 1945, they were transferred by the Germans to Bergen-Belsen, where they were liberated as the war ended. In 1939, there were 3,300,000 Jews in Poland. In 1945, only 300,000 survived. My uncle was a living testimony to the Shoah and the 6 million Kedoshim. Finally, in a few years later, my uncle of Rome, Dr. Lipshitz, emigrated to the United States. Now, as a kid growing up in the 1950s and 60s, Orthodox Judaism was not as strong as it is today. There were few day schools and even fewer yeshivas. At that time, it looked as if the conservative and reform movements would be triumphant. However, my uncle of Rome never wavered in his commitment to Yiddishkeit. He was a bridge, as Rabbi Friedman mentioned, between pre-war Jewish Poland and the United States. He never forgot the true values that he was instilled with. He was always able to see what was important, and no matter what, he stayed committed to it. When I think of my uncle of Rome, there are three major values that come to mind. The first we already mentioned in Sanhedrin. Goris v'araisa tadiro v'lo machzik tibuso nashe. From the time I was a little kid, the only thing I remember my uncle doing is sitting and learning. He lived in a small apartment on Tallman Avenue, and in the small apartment he had a small office where the walls were lined with sparring. It was a tiny base medrash. The only thing smaller than that office was they had a sukkah, and the sukkah was literally only machzik rosho v'rubo. The sukkah was the size of a phone booth. I could barely read Hebrew, but I knew whenever I entered that base medrash, that office where my uncle was sitting and learning, I knew that that was an extremely special, special place. He himself, though, never expected any special treatment for his learning. For years, he worked as a shochet at Shapetti Packing House. He would get up early in the morning, drive to the south side, chef in the morning, and then he would come home and sit and learn the rest of the day. Lo machzi tivuse l'nafshe. He never sat at the front of a shul. Wherever he came, if you didn't know him, you would think of him as just an ordinary guy. The second major value that he had, what Rosie mentioned, was Eretz Yisrael, and to be honest, also Medinat Yisrael. I remember that he went to Israel before it was popular to go. He went before the Six-Day War. And I remember that after he came back from Israel, he brought back pictures of the Era Atika and the walls that surround the old city. But the pictures were taken through a window, because at that time when he went, Jews weren't allowed in the Era Atika, and they weren't allowed at the Kotel. He was finally able to fulfill his dream of making Aliyah. And while unfortunately his final days in Israel were not perfect, his overall life could be called perfect because of the final value. Together with his wife, Hella, he raised two daughters. I know whenever I would walk into their condo on Tui, Hella would have a row of pictures, each individually framed, with each great-grandchild on the counter. And there were a lot of pictures, Kanai Nahara. Just for Michal, there were a lot of pictures. But it wasn't just the quality of the pictures. It wasn't just the quantity of the pictures. It was the quality of his descendants. Abi and Annie, Avra and Rosie, Michal, Ari, Dani, Betsy and Akiva, Alicia, Daron and Meira, all their children, all their grandchildren, all their great-grandchildren, all their great-great-grandchildren, all Shomrei Torah mitzvahs. Rosie and Annie living in Eretz Yisrael, Talmidei Chachamim and Chayalim, the best that Yadus has to offer. This is my uncle of Rome's true legacy, to rise from the ashes of Poland and to begin to rebuild the Torah and Mishpachas that were destroyed. Yehi Zichro Baruch.
Show and tell also. First, I want to thank the yeshiva for conducting this memorial here for Dr. Lipshitz and for inviting me back to Chicago. Happy to be here again. You should all know that Chicago is still the greatest city in the world. And the Jewish community here is the greatest Jewish community. Now, I told my wife I was going to say that, and she said she doesn't think Dr. Lipshitz agrees. So Dr. Lipshitz would say that this is the second greatest community in the world, and Yerushalayim is the first. But, okay, I'm not here to say a eulogy. It's not in my style at all. But Dr. Lipshitz really lived an amazing life, really several lives. It was his prior to World War II life, during the war, and then a part of the life that I never even knew about. He rarely spoke about the war years, and he never told me anything about what happened after the war years. I never knew that he was in Hanover, Germany from 45 till 48 or so, and he was really one of the leaders of the community. And I was doing some research on his life. I did some Googling, okay, and I came up with two pictures. I can't see them, but here's one of them. Two pictures of him in Hanover, Germany. He was a member of the board that ran the community, and it seems like he was considered the love of the community. What picture is this one? Is this the...
Hanover.
Okay, I can't see the...
Yeah, she speaks on the...
These are the ashes?
Buried the boxes.
Yes. He was the one who said the Kabbalah. He was really a leader in the community. He never spoke about it. But he was, I think there are two pictures. Another one shows him sitting with the council that ran there was a DP camp, I guess. I don't know what was there at that time. But in probably a displaced person camp in Hanover, and he was on the board running the community. He never spoke about these things. And like all of you mentioned before, he was really anonymous, really a person who didn't talk about himself at all. After Germany, he came in 1948 to Chicago, to the United States, to Chicago. So he had the study years, his years that he did study here in school. He had his teaching years, and his final years there at zt'l. Just want to tell a little personal story. About 2 months ago, in the middle of December, from the middle of December to the middle of January, my wife Hadassah and I, took a trip to Eretz Yisrael. And before I took the trip, I called Abi, and that's Abi's the son-in-law. I called Abi and asked him if I could see his father-in-law. He said, he's really very frail. He doesn't know if he recognized me. But I said I really wanted to see him. So when I got there to Israel, I called Annie, Rosie's sister, and I called Annie and asked if I could go over there. She told me where it was, Tamir Nursing Home or something like that. And I took the bus and went over there. And as I came there, she was there at the same time. So she said, let me bring my father out. She brought him out. I was so excited to see him. He really did not recognize me, and he could barely lift his head up. He was very, very frail. But I was so excited to see him. I sat down with him and just talked to Andy for a while. And it was like the high point I had when I was in Eretz Israel. And then a few days later, when we came back, Rabbi Eisenberg called me and said he just passed away. So maybe I was the last visitor to see him in Eretz Israel. I don't know. But I want to talk a little about his life in Chicago, mainly about his intellectual endeavors in Chicago. That's mainly what he was. He came to Chicago in 1948, and he was here for, I guess, about 60 years, until he went to Eretz Yisrael. Someone mentioned he was a shaykh during part of that time, but he was always studying something. And he decided that he wants to be a scholar. That's really what he wants to be. So he went back to school, had to learn English. He couldn't speak English. The language in the house was only Yiddish. He knew German. Actually, German might have been the reason his knowing of German might have saved his life. He once told me a story. I say he rarely told me stories about his life in the war. But he told me a story that, that there was a German officer in the this was in Lodz, in the ghetto, and they asked Dr. Lipshitz to be his valet because he knew German. So he became the valet of this German officer. And he said from that he learned a lesson. He learned you could be so well educated and still be a monster. What is it? This man, this officer, had a PhD. Usually we think very educated people are people of reason, people of empathy and so on. He said this man had a PhD, but he was a monster. And he once told Dr. Lipshitz, he said that there are only two nations that could really run the world. And that's the Jews and the Germans. So we have to eliminate those Jews because we want to take over the world. I say he knew languages. He was very, very good at languages. And he picked up English really quickly to the point that he went on and got a PhD in, from the University of Chicago. He actually had two PhDs. He got a PhD from the, a doctorate degree from HTC in Hebrew Letters, and he had a doctorate in philosophy from the University of Chicago. So he just never stood still. But I want to discuss his scholarly endeavors, and that concludes his studying, his teaching, and his writing. As I said, he was able to earn two PhDs. He continued his studies in the yeshiva at the time, his Jewish studies, and his secular studies, and eventually, at the University of Chicago, he wasn't on the faculty, but he was an assistant to Dr. Gold, which was one of the leading, Dr. Gold was a leading scholar at the University of Chicago. And Dr. Gold published a book, and he collaborated with Dr. Lipshitz on this book. As far as his teaching goes, I don't know when he started teaching at the Chicago Jewish Academy. He started teaching at Chicago Jewish Academy, which is now the Idaho Academy. Then he went over and started teaching at the HTC. I didn't know him during any of those years. By the way, can you see the third picture of, we see the third one right there? Okay. You know, I realized that that third picture, I don't know who put it together, a modern picture of Dr. Lipshitz, but whoever put it together, if you were to look at it, you would never know that was Dr. Lipshitz, because there was no cap on. He didn't have his cap. He always wore his cap. I see that Norbert continues the tradition, but he always had his cap on. So whenever you saw him in the street or anywhere, he always was with that cap. So when I saw the picture, I thought, oh, something missing. But that was his, and then he had this class. How many years did the class go on, your Shabbos class? 49 years. He had a Shabbos class for 49 years that he taught. Dr. Skolnick was there, or you, and I don't know who everybody was. And he started teaching the graduate school here at the yeshiva. I should mention, by the way, I wanted to mention that the yeshiva in those days, nowadays probably also, that they had truly great scholars on their faculty. They had really, really great scholars. I'll just list a few, but they had Dr. Lipshitz, they had Rabbi Eisenberg in Hebrew and Tanakh, they had Dr. Rabat in Tanakh, they had Dr. Berkowitz in philosophy, Dr. Mishkin in historiography, and Rabbi Zimmerman, Hirschner, and Salvechik in Shas. So they had really great people there. And Dr. Lipshitz was on that staff. That's when I first got to meet Dr. Lipshitz in the graduate department. He was teaching courses in the graduate school at the yeshiva. I don't know if it was Jewish, he was at the University of America at that time. I'm not sure what it was called. I don't remember when I started taking courses with him, but I did find a note from 1988. So somewhere back there, at least 20 years that I took courses with him. And his classes were always so interesting, so exceptional, so well developed. Just to give you an idea of some of the courses he taught, first one was on Hebrew vocalization. Maybe you could show what this is. What is it in Hebrew vocalization? Nikud and Tamim, and so we accept this fact the way our Nikudos are. We don't think about them. Why is it this form? Why is it this shape? And so on. But really, the Nikudos we have a long history. There was an earlier Nikud called Nikud Bavli, and I think this is a picture of Nikud Bavli. Nikud Bavli, you have the Nikudos on top of the words instead of underneath the words. And there was a Nikud Eretz Yisrael. There were various way types of Nikudos and various customs how we read those Nikudos too. And the Nikud that we nowadays use is called Nikud Tiberian. It was developed in Tiberian. You just have to think about these. There are a lot of customs we have about our Nikudos and our pronunciation that are kind of strange. Like I listed a few. For instance, why is it that if a letter ends in a shvo, we don't put the shvo there, we don't put the two dots. But in a word like at, or at and derech and so on, where there's a chof or a tof, we do put a nikud there. Why one place not, one place yet? Somebody had to think that up, and somebody had to have a good reason for it. And that was part of nikud tiberia. Why, when we have a gronis, when we end the word with a patah, a gronis, like the word Noah, we add an aleph. And why don't we know ha? It's becha, sagbiha. So why do we have to add an aleph? Where did that come from? That's part of Nikud Tiberia. That was part of the way that they decided how we, for some reason, they had a reason for it, why they developed it that way. So many of the rules, let's see. Well, here's a good question you could ask. Why is it that a shin has, for a shin, we put a dot on the right side. For a sin on the left side, why do we have to have a dot for each one? We should just have nothing for the shin, and when there's a sin, we put a dot. But there was a reason why they decided that they want a dot on each side, not just leave it like that. So this was his course in Nikud. I really brought along, and whenever he gave a course, he gave a handout like this, about 10,000 pages long, and it was an 8-week course, and you had to read all of that in those 8 weeks. It means you did nothing, you never slept for a good 8 weeks or so, never ate or slept. This was typically what he did, but what every course looked like. And so that was, I'd say, just give you a sample of some of his courses. Here's just to see the variety. A course on the debate between the Jews and Christians, and a whole course on that, it's a famous debate. A course on the dispute between the Rabbanim and the Koroyim. He did a study of Sefer Kitzonim, the Apocryphy, Parshanut HaTanakh, HaMikra, between Rabbi Nasadigo and Rabbi Yitzchak Aravanel. These were all courses that he taught. I don't remember how many courses I took. I took as many as I could. And they were always, always, always interesting and marvelous. When it came to his writing, he wrote many scholarly articles, but he also produced 6 books. They just give you the names of the books so you can see the idea. Iyunim Belshonus Ravov, Ibn Ezra should say, Pirkei Iyun Mishnas Rabbi Avraham Ibn Ezra, Pirush Rabbi Avraham Ibn Ezra, Yoel, his Pirush and Hosea. So, 4 Sforim on Ibn Ezra. Then he wrote this Zichron Meir Don that Leon mentioned, a small book with correspondence of his father with Gedolim at that time. And this very large book he put out, he was producing till the year 2000, really. His last book was Iyunim Gebira Torah, Rabbi Bachai, Ben Asher. It was Rabbi Bachai. That was in 2000. He was always producing. But we see that his fascination was, I told someone to stop me when I spoke. Someone should take away the mic, it's okay. Stop. Okay. He was fascinated with Ibn Ezra. And let me just say a few words about it. He was really fascinated with Ibn Ezra. And he used to sometimes talk about a letter that the Rambam wrote, famous letter of the Rambam to his son. Here's what, I'll just read a few lines. He says, how true and authentic are the interpretations of the wise scholar Abraham Ibn Ezra of sacred memory. I learned that he wrote a commentary on the Torah which reveals profound, essential, esoteric truths, comprehensible only to the intellectual equals, who alas are few in number. Then he goes on and tells his son, as for you, my faithful son, I exhort you not to pay attention or divert your mind on commentaries, treatises, or books other than those of Ibn Ezra, which alone are meaningful and profitable to all who study them, with intelligent understanding and deep insight. So he used to refer to that letter often to say that that's why he works at Ibn Ezra so much. I'm going to skip all this and just say, as we got closer and our friendship developed, as I took these courses, he started talking to me about, why don't you undertake some kind of working on one of Ibn Ezra books. In other words, to make a critical edition. Critical edition is an edition trying to find out what was the original form of the text and also variations in Kisveyat. So you work with Kisveyat and you work with older editions and so on and try to find out what the true text should be. Because all the gross gedolos that we have hundreds and hundreds of mistakes in them. They were written in the 1500s. The first gross gedolos was written by a non-Jewish publisher in the 1500s, Daniel Bamberg. It was the Bamberg Press. But he hired scholars, and they put out the first gross gedolos. The gross gedolos was a Tanakh together with Mefarshim on the page. By the way, the Bamberg Press put out about 200 sforim in Hebrew. It was specifically for Hebrew. And, for example, our Talmud Bavli, why is it that we start with Daf Beis, we have the Rashi here, the Tosfos there, everybody knows where Daf Chof Beis Omed Gimel is or something. Everybody knows in that pagination. That was from the Bamberg Press. Came from a non-Jewish press. They developed it, and everything in all our Shas and came from there. But they put out the first Mikros Gedolos also. They did really two editions. The first one had many, many, many errors, and it was kind of condemned. And so they put out the second edition. The second edition was a much improved edition. All the Mikros Gedolos after that just copied that Mikros Gedolos. So if there was a mistake in the first one, there was a mistake in all of them. What do I mean by mistake? They only had Kisveyat, they only had handwritten manuscripts. So they took a manuscript and they used it to produce the printed text or so. So they had this manuscript. And the manuscripts were all written over hundreds of years, one from the other, so there was an enormous number of mistakes. So he said, I should take on that. And at first I refused and so on, and then, so finally I did it and I produced EO. Let me just tell you about Dr. Lipshitz's patience. He said he would correct it for me or work with me. So I would take a parrot of EO and I'd work on it and feel really good about myself and hand it to him. And I'll tell you, today I get it back with about 10,000 corrections. Every word I wrote had to be corrected. He put an arrow here and a line here, and you never see how he writes. If the arrows were all over the side and even on the edges, I think, and so on. And he'd always have all these notes, and he would correct everything I wrote. And I would do it again, and he would correct it again. Went on a lot like that. I was sure at some point he's going to say, why don't you just give up? or if you teach math, go back to your math, don't bother. But he persevered, and he pushed me through it, came up with you, and I finished it. And from then on, I really have him to thank for everything I do nowadays. Because all I do is work, really, to teach a little math also, but I made it work in Ibn Ezra. So it's the conditions. Thank you. I skipped all my pictures. But it's all right. Oh, by the way, I brought one of his books. This is his Pirush and Hosea.
Stand here to try and
some manner to do justice to such a noble life. My predecessors here certainly have done it very, very eloquently. I'd like just to, in the time we have left, do two things. I'd like to be able to room a piece that was written by his devoted Talmudim in the Tanakh study by Dr. Lipshitz. Never, by the way, to call him Rabbi Lipshitz does not do him justice. To call him Dr. Lipshitz doesn't do him justice. I had the great honor of being the dean or a dean through the last part of his career here. That was an honor. And I could never just say Rabbi Lipshitz. Could never just say Dr. Lipshitz. He didn't ask, he didn't care. But I always felt whatever I called him, I tried to call him always Rabbi Dr. Lipshitz. Because indeed, he brought honor to both of those titles. So I'm going to read this, and then I'll just conclude with a very brief statement. In the spring of 1965, on a Shabbos, a few days before Pesach, a recent newlywed Norman Rosenthal bumped into Rabbi Lipshitz in the corridor of Congregation Bnei Reuven in West Rogers Park. Mr. Rosenthal had met Rabbi Lipshitz a couple of times prior and had heard that he was a very capable and knowledgeable teacher in one or more of the Chedorah of Chicago, and also possibly a teacher in the then Chicago Jewish Academy. Mr. Rosenthal, who was a Muslim based minister, asked Rabbi Lipshitz if he would be willing to study Tanakh with several young men on Shabbos and Yom Tovim in West Rogers Park. Rabbi Lipshitz answered that he would like to think about it, but he would get back to Mr. Rosenthal in a few days. After just 3 days, Rabbi Lipshitz indeed called him back with a yes. The initial members of the study group included Rabbi Abraham Brothenstein, David Blumhoff, Olav Shalom, Bernard Newman, Moshe Menorah, Olav Shalom, and Mr. Rosenthal. Little did we know that that was the beginning of a long-term love between us, Rabbi Lipshitz, and Tanakh. Our shir extended for most of the next 49 years, devoted to the study of Tanakh, with classic proportion and the works of other medieval scholars growing regularly in our respective homes in Lincolnwood and West Rogers Park. The shir continued after Rabbi Lipshitz moved to Lincolnwood, but we still met regularly in the homes of our members on Motzei Shabbos, on Sunday evenings, As a result of our study together, Rabbi Lipshitz imbued within us a deep love for learning, and he gave us the keys and tools with which to study and understand the Nevi'im and Ksuvim in depth. Rabbi Lipshitz's impact on the lives of the students is best represented also by the hundreds he taught and befriended outside of the formal classroom. He studied with us for approximately 49 years, almost five decades, until his aliyah to Eretz Israel with his devoted wife, Ella, in the year 2014. During this period, we were able to observe a full measure of the giant he really was, not merely a world-renowned scholar, author, and teacher. He was also the personification of Torah in Derech Eretz. It was the latter character trait of Menshevkite that we experienced the most, and which endeared him personally to each of us. He was a man of great modesty, and wouldn't mind being addressed by some of us simply as A. He never sought compensation. He invested in our sessions together, and he always was prepared. Moreover, he and Hella opened their home to us on many occasions where we enjoyed the flavor of a refined, cultured European home. He would occasionally illustrate our discussions with recollections of being the son of an acknowledged Torah scholar. His father earned a modest living in the world of commerce in World War II Poland. Rabbi Lipshitz introduced us to the world of everyday Jewish life in the famous Jewish city of his birth, Rudzhkov, before, during, and after the Holocaust. Our classes became for us an intellectual journey in Tanakh, applied to all aspects of Jewish life in our own day. The world The Navi Micha is remembered for his famous statement, Yipecha Adam Matov, Ma Hashem Yoresh Yimcha, Kiim Asot Mishpat, Avat Chesed, Asmei Alechet, Imanukecha. It has been told to thee, O man, what is good, and what the Lord has required of thee, only to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God. The ending, to walk humbly with God, is a most fitting description of a remarkable teacher, and the mensch that we were privileged to have had as a teacher, advisor, and friend during all those memorable years. Over that time, Rabbi Lipshitz touched the lives not only of us, the members of the study, but also the lives of our spouses, our children, who often sat in our shiurim retreat and on Yom Tov. Our members came with different backgrounds, having been born or raised in America, Israel, or Europe. But we all agreed with one of our members, Max Klein, who moved away from Chicago to Washington, D.C. some years back. Max told us he looked for someone like Rabbi Lipshitz for many years after he moved away, but told us that despite all his searching, he could not find another teacher or a scholar like Rabbi Lipshitz. He hears his role both. This has been presented in collaboration by Dr. Irving Skolny, Mr. Norbert Rosenthal, past coordinators of the Rabbi A. Lipshitz Tanakh Study. Not much to add, but I'd just like to say, just because I had truly the great schus and wonderful experience of being a dean where Dr. Lipshitz taught and inspired so many people. I just want to say the last parak of the Torah, the last parak. The Torah calls Moshe Rabbeinu by three appellations. The Torah usually describes behavior. It doesn't usually give titles. The Torah doesn't call Yosef Atzadik necessarily, or Rabbeinu. It describes behaviors. But in the very last parak, in all of the Torah, HaKadosh Baruch Hu departs from that pattern. He gives Moshe Rabbeinu three appellations. Ish Moshe, Ish Elokim. He was indeed a man of God. He was called Eved Hashem, the servant of God, and he's called Navi, prophet. I'd like to just share with you one brief thought. When you think about it, a Navi and an Eved are almost antithetical. A Navi is a creative force, perhaps the most creative force of a human being, able to bridge generations through his words or her words, to be able to reach, hopefully not always succeeding, but the ability to reach people through not merely repeating things, but each Navi had his own style, his own way of doing. Because perhaps a Yeshayahu who had to talk to one group of people could not necessarily do what others did, Yirmiyahu, Triassi. On the other hand, an Eved is the absolute opposite. The Eved is a person who never leaves the exact form that he's to follow. The pattern that is given to him, that is what he does. An Eved who is asked to bring his master a sandwich and he chooses to bring on a steak is no Eved. He might be well intentioned, but he's no Eved. Moshe Rabbeinu had within him the ability to be creative, the great creative force that Moshe Rabbeinu was, whether it was in his second Tochacha or even in the recollection of the Aseret Dibro for the second time and so many other things. He had a tremendous capacity for being creative. He was, on the other hand, an Eved that did not deviate even one chut from HaKadosh Baruch Hu's work. For most of us, to be creative or to be obedient are two difficult things. They reside very, very uneasily within us. Because in the end, Most of us have to choose to be primarily one or the other. Moshe Rabbeinu allowed both his obedience and his creativity to reside in perfect harmony within him. So it was with Rabbi Dr. Lipshitz. He knew when to be creative. His writing, his studying, his engaging with the teachers, and the teachers and the students, and with the person who was the dean, and he knew when to be an eved, more so than I would ever have liked. But he would come to me and say, what do you want me to do? I'll do it the way you want me to do it. I was often astounded. A person of such stature did not deviate from anything that he thought was this. So indeed, today we pay great tribute this evening to a person who was an eved, but he had to be an eved, and who was nothing, a creative person, certainly when he had to be that. And just as Moshe Rabbeinu, when they both resided in harmony, what does the Torah call him? Ish Elokim. I can say without hesitation that Rabbi Dr. A. Lipshitz, Avraham Lipshitz, was an Eved, a Navi, and an Ish Elokim.
Please rise. Thank you all for coming.